wildlife package, take one.
That alarmed residents and conservationists because it meant pushing a six-lane highway through the unspoilt Hougham Valley. Our cameraman, Derek Budd, lives at Hougham, and he's a keen naturalist, so he decided to record on film the beauty of this threatened area. And his exploration led him to find out what, if anything, might grow up in his place. This report now from Peter Carlton.
Hougham Valley, a scattering of farms and hamlets lying just behind the main road from Folkestone to Dover, which is why it's missed by so many travellers. But to the planners, the contours of this valley are ideal for a sweeping, high-speed motorway bend round the side of the hill in the middle distance. Tracts of land like this are being eaten up for motorway development at the rate of around 40 miles every year. That's in addition to around 50 miles a year, chewed up by new trunk roads. Every mile of completed motorway, the contractors have to manoeuvre their lumbering equipment and huge prefabricated concrete sections across up to 26 acres of land. It's almost impossible to believe the natural environment can recover from such a man-made burden. But as the last machine thunders off the site, life is already beginning to re-emerge, and the process of regeneration can be assisted by the planners and builders themselves. The first M-class road in Britain was the Maidstone Bypass, opened in December 1960. It's now part of the M20, and from this small beginning, there are now more than 1,500 miles of motorway, covering more than 30,000 acres of what used to be woodland or open countryside. But the mature banks of the Maidstone Bypass show how a different wildlife chain can develop, as the banks have been allowed to grow wild. Until 7 years ago, the verges were regularly trimmed back. But then money became tight, so the motorway manicures were stopped. When a section of road is completed, the contractors seed the bank with a mixture of grasses, partly for cosmetic effect and partly to prevent landslips. They've experimented with a number of varieties over the years, but a common factor is white clover, which helps to encourage growth by liberating nitrogen into the topsoil. The process is assisted by early germinating plants like scentless mayweed and groundsel. The first plants to recolonize the verges naturally are those whose seeds are dispersed on the wind. The constant traffic rushing past only a few feet away ensures an even spread. This is travellers' joy, though few travellers on this road are driving slowly enough to get much joy out of it. But even the fastest motorists should have time to recognise the poppy, whose seeds are so resilient they can lie dormant on hard ground for up to 50 years. Another wind-propagated plant, toadflax, also known as bunny's ears. It's related to the more familiar snapdragon. And, like the poppy, its tiny seeds are dispersed by the wind with a high degree of efficiency. As time passes and the banks mature, the new vegetation takes a hold, allowing larger and more dense shrubs to put down roots and spread, like the bright yellow gorse. If anything, these hardy bushes can take too strong a hold, and they sometimes need sympathetic control if they're not to strangle everything around. But the larger shrubs provide essential cover for small animals and insects. In turn, these creatures assist by spreading seeds or pollen as they scurry or flutter from place to place. This is the guelder rose, a type of viburnum, which attracts visitors hungry for nectar with its outer ring of petals. But it's the inner seed cluster which is ultimately more important to the plant's survival. Some plants have taken the attraction of pollinating insects to a level of great sophistication. Any bee passing by this exotic variety would be drawn by the sight of another honeybee sipping pollen. Only it's not a real bee, just the bee orchid, which has evolved in this form as a way of perpetuating the species. A number of orchids are recorded on the M20. Here, for instance, the common spotted variety, a prosaic name which belies the delicate patterning on its petals. And orchids aren't the only unlikely customers on the untouched verges. Just nearby, another reminder of summer, the wild strawberry. This is the wayfaring tree, another type of viburnum. It's encouraged because it helps to prevent erosion of the verge. The planners have tried to plant trees to provide a windbreak on exposed stretches of road. These are young oak. But they, in turn, need to be protected, not from erosion, but from the rabbits who enjoy eating young shoots. The rabbits colonize much of the bank, particularly around junctions where the soil's been well turned over. But this can lead to even more erosion, as the rabbits dig deep, loosening large areas of topsoil. So they, too, have to be controlled. The county council employ licensed hunters to keep them down using ferrets. But it's not just rabbits that form subterranean colonies. The verges make an excellent home for large numbers of ants, which feed on roadside detritus, including other insects killed by the traffic. All of this, of course, goes unnoticed by the motorway's users, many of whom use the banks more as a convenient litter bin. But even this unsightly mess is put to use. These young grasshoppers seem to be enjoying an all-over tan as they sun themselves on a metallic wrapper. And some other creatures benefit from the salt put down in icy conditions. It's been shown that the larvae of the brown-tail moth thrive on the downpour of sodium when the air's drenched in salt spray. And the salt helps to discourage predators which would normally keep the population down. The larvae also benefit from high levels of nitrogen oxide pollution found in the air around busy trunk roads, because nitrogen speeds up growth in their favourite food plants. So, for the brown tail at least, pollution isn't necessarily poisonous. This is, though. The six-spot burnet moth displays its toxic powers by the glaring red blotches on its wings. The message to potential predators is clear. Look, but don't touch. Other moths and butterflies abound, mostly those varieties which thrive on chalk downland. Here's the skipper, identifiable by its double-folded wings. This pair have little difficulty in maintaining their precarious hold as they mate, even in the gusts caused by passing traffic. And the blues, this one's a chalk hill, which with luck will avoid the fate of its cousin, the large blue, officially declared extinct in this country last year. Here's another blue, the beautiful Adonis. And from the blues to the browns, this is the hedge brown, more commonly known as the gatekeeper, and a similar species, the small heath. These varieties thrive on the M20's plant life, and in turn form an essential part of the diet of larger creatures. This meadow pipit has been attracted to the roadside by the plentiful food supply. Rather larger are these rooks, looking for seeds and carrion at the side of the road. But perhaps the most successful avian adaptation to motorway existence is the kestrel, now so familiar stalking its favourite prey of voles along the verge. The kestrel's old country name of windhover describes how it uses the wind to suspend itself, from a distance apparently motionless, but a close look shows how the bird is continually adjusting its fanned tail and the pitch of its wings to maintain the same position against the air currents. The kestrel has taken over from the sparrowhawk as Britain's most numerous bird of prey, because it seems to have adapted much better to habitat changes, even nesting on tall city buildings and busy industrial sites, like this one in Chatham's Naval Dockyard, in which six youngsters were reared. A survey by members of the Kent Field Club in 1978 found more than 300 species of flowering plant on the M20's verge, as well as nearly 30 types of butterfly and many other insect species. Though few people get the chance to see this roadside sanctuary, its value to wildlife cannot be overstressed, especially at a time when modern farming and urban development are destroying wild habitat at the rate of 30,000 acres a year. The argument for its retention is currently being won by conservationists, just as they won at Hougham, where we began. That valley has now been spared the fate of having to play host to the M20 extension. Nevertheless, the motorway verges are now proven to offer a home for many species which are fast declining elsewhere. The process of adaptation continues, and will continue, as long as the economic and ecological arguments for leaving well alone happen to coincide.
The fascinating and beautiful story of the wildlife near our motorways.